Holy Grail and its connection with the Last Supper. The Holy Grail is particularly associated with Jesus and the cup of wine used at the Last Supper, which was the Passover meal that Jesus enjoyed with his disciples just before his betrayal and crucifixion. The story of the Last Supper begins with Jesus asking two of his disciples to go to Jerusalem to prepare the Passover meal for him. This was in fact part of a ritual, a dramatic acting out of the great mystery that took place over several days, which involved not only Jesus, but also his disciples. And this is not often realized. Well, to quote from the Bible, on the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, his disciples said to Jesus, "Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So Jesus sent Peter and John, saying to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him, and wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher says, my time is near. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples. Where is the guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. Now the raising, offering, blessing and teaching and sharing of the Holy Grail, which goes on in this meal, is a symbolic action that is also represented by the Kabbalistic Tree of Life, wherein the Grail, which is number 10, the kingdom at the foot of this tree, which is also known as the Bride, is raised to become the Holy Grail, united with the Holy Trinity and manifesting as the crown jewel of creation. This is the mystical marriage, where in number 10, the Grail or Bride, becomes number 3, the illumined Holy Grail, filled with the wisdom of her beloved, the groom, which is number 2 on the Tree of Life, and pregnant with love and knowledge of that wisdom. In such unity, they become one in love, and the child of light, of knowledge of truth, is born. And the blazing star represents this revelation of truth, which is in fact revelation of number 1, the source of everything. This revelation is then shared, and this is shown by number 4, mercy, the right hand of God on high, shared through by that means. But first, to achieve all this, one must become number 10, the root of the tree of life, and be properly prepared. And this is the initial sacrifice that must be made. And all this Jesus acted out with his disciples. I'm going to show here my diagram of the human chakras and the zodiac signs associated with parts of the human body and the chakras. So I'll walk you through it this way. So to start with, the pool of Siloam, where the water was collected, and the feet of the disciples walking the ground are associated with the zodiac sign of Pisces, which is associated with the feet. The disciples then follow the water bearer Aquarius to the house on Mount Zion. To do this, the water bearer and the two disciples must climb Mount Zion in Jerusalem in order to reach the house. So from Pisces, they go to Aquarius, Capricorn, Sagittarius, to Scorpio, the base of the spine. And the body is the house. Or the house is the body. Once the house is reached and the password given, important this password, the disciples have to ascend the stairs inside the house in order to reach the upper room. So we ascend now inside the body, inside the house, up to the upper room, which is represented at the throat chakra and outer major chakra ruled by Taurus. Taurus and the outer major chakra. And this is the upper room where the Last Supper is to take place, which is a sacred meal involving feasting and inspired teaching. Then after the feast, all the disciples with Jesus go to the Mount of Olives. The olive is a symbol of peace, and olive oil is the original holy oil used to baptize the heads of those who are being prepared to become sovereigns or illumined ones. So from Taurus, we go up into Aries, the head. Then follows the betrayal, arrest, trial, and condemnation of Jesus. Aries then becomes what's known as the Agnus Dei, the sacrificial lamb of God. And Aries falls to the feet, down to Pisces. And the sacrifice known as crucifixion leads to initiatic death and then resurrection, followed by ascension to the seventh heaven and becoming one with the spirit of the Messiah, the spirit of Christ. Resurrection and ascension concern the arousal and rising of the kundalini through all the chakras, right up to the crown chakra, producing full enlightenment. So in the tree of life, the seventh heaven is represented by the blazing Christ star or Hex Alpha, the unnumbered sephira known as knowledge, which knowledge is illumination or revelation of truth. This, as I said before, is the manifestation of number one, the crown, the otherwise hidden source of all. This is then followed by the sharing of this seventh heaven revelation. So this is said in the Bible as Jesus Christ being seated on the right hand of God, which is mercy, to teach wisdom and bestow mercy. So number four, the tree of life. And then coming to judge the quick and the dead. So there we go to number five, which is the judgment sephira. The raising of the grail symbolizes the kundalini, which is the intelligence or soul consciousness, rising up and illuminating all the chakras right up to the crown chakra. And each of the seven major chakras is associated with a type or level of consciousness, and these are equated with the seven heavens. Now, the famous biblical example of water turned to wine occurs during the marriage of Cana. The marriage of Cana is actually what's known traditionally as the Haros Gamos, the sacred marriage. And in Jesus' story, it was his marriage to Mary Magdalene, his wife, his bride and then wife, both of whom were carefully prepared. Mary, the bride, is symbolized by the grail of pure water, who becomes the holy grail of wine when filled with wisdom and enlightened by it. Jesus, the groom, has the wisdom that impregnates Mary, his bride. When married, Mary is the holy grail, and Jesus, her husband, is her protector, the guardian of the holy grail. Now, there is a story of Mary's casting out of seven demons with the help of Jesus. And this actually refers to her own soul progression through the seven heavens of consciousness to reach full enlightenment and marriage with Jesus. Because each heaven is symbolized by a planet and said to be ruled by a planetary spirit known as a demon. So I'll show this in this particular tree of life. So the seven planetary heavens are also equated with the seven major degrees of initiation. So you pass each degree when you've symbolically defeated the demon. The demon comes to test and also to teach. It's the hierophant of each heaven. So you go Moon, Mercury, Sun, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn is the usual way it is shown. And in the seventh heaven, Mary's marriage to Jesus occurs, followed by the birth of their child of light, two things happen almost simultaneously. And the child, manifestation of the unity of the parents in love and full knowledge of that love and its wisdom, that knowledge is what we call illumination, real illumination. And this is symbolized by the Christ star. Now the Holy Grail, or the illumined soul, is also represented by what's called the face of bride, that we see in many of the works of the Renaissance, both in carvings, but also in paintings and in printed works, such as the Shakespeare works and works by Francis Bacon.
It is now generally believed that Neoplatonism was founded by a man called Ammonius Saccas. Ammonius Saccas was a sort of North African Aesop. He was a strange man, of no education as far as is known, and his name implies his trade. He was a carrier of bundles, burdens, and tropes. The rise of Neoplatonism is a mystery, and has always remained a mystery. Yet there is a dark hint that behind Ammonius Saccas was another person, that for some reason this other person chose to be represented by the common bearer of burdens. Now, who is this bearer of burdens? Perhaps it is the same bearer of which there is reference in the Bible, of cast your burdens upon the Lord. Also, there are many concepts of Jesus as bearing the burden of the world's woe, or bearing the burden of mortal sin. This burden bearer keeps appearing in many localities, certainly a possible symbolic statement or concept. But who and what was the force behind this? It is quite possible that these persons simply represented teachers or initiated masters sent out of the schools or out of the mystery system, or stepping in because of their superior knowledge into the vacuum left by the collapse of popular theology and moving the entire concept onto a new level.